start this session on the guidelines on dual antiplatelet therapy on behalf of the task force of these guidelines. These are my disclosures, and this is a summary of the evidence, the main evidence that has been produced in terms of the clinical efficacy on dual antiplatelet therapy during these 21 years. During the next minutes, I will try to show you the change in paradigm for what DAPT started using, which is treating off stents, to the wider understanding of how DAPT can be used for the treatment of a disease, and particularly for patients. Also, I will introduce a little bit the methods with which we have tried to help the making decisions on dual antiplatelet therapy in our document. So the story started in the 90s, in the 1990s, with ticlopidine, which was a big step for stents, when which oral anticoagulation was initially used, and the use of ticlopidine was a huge step. So aspirin and ticlopidine was essentially used for the treatment of stent, and mainly for the prevention of stent thrombosis. However, the second big step was the development of clopidogrel and the use of clopidogrel. The biggest study actually which had been developed so far was CURE. What CURE was actually not a trial on acute coronary syndrome. As you can see, the perimeters of the circle, this is in red, which means patients with acute coronary syndrome, in this particular case with non-ST elevation acute coronary syndromes, and proved that dual antiplatelet therapy with aspirin and clopidogrel actually was superior to aspirin alone. That actually changed the management of acute coronary syndromes, but also the management of stents, and ticlopidine was really abandoned, and even without big evidence for the management of stents, it replaced the use of ticlopidine. Later on, the biggest ever study in this field, the COMET, the Chinese study with more than 40,000 patients, actually evaluated the role of clopidogrel in patients with acute myocardial infarction. And then a number also very important studies like CREDO for PCI, and particularly CHARISMA for patients with established cardiovascular disease, or patients at high risk without cardiovascular disease, evaluated the role of dual antiplatelet therapy in this. Clarity evaluated the role of dual antiplatelet therapy, in particular clopidogrel, in patients with fibrinolysis. And finally, the OASIS 7 study evaluated two different doses of clopidogrel in patients with acute coronary syndrome. It was in the 2007 and 9 when the two new kits in the block came. The Triton and the Plato trials actually put on the table prasugrel and ticagrelor in patients with acute coronary syndromes. Triton in acute coronary syndromes treated with PCI, in Plato and acute coronary syndromes treated with either strategy, medical management, PCI, which was the majority of patients, or CABG. So we had again now four options, and then a number of studies consolidated the use of this treatment. Trilogy ACS compare prasugrel with clopidogrel in medically managed non-STA patients. A Coast and Atlantic compare early versus late versus later administration on the dual on the P2Y12 inhibitor in patients with non-ST and with STEMI. And Prague was the only comparison between the two potent antiplatelets. A number of smaller studies have investigated different strategies to guide the use of dual antiplatelet therapy. Also, there's been studies evaluating the role of dual antiplatelet therapy in association with other therapies, particularly anticoagulation. And finally, there's a real plethora of randomized trials, many of them small, but two large ones, addressing different timings for the duration of dual antiplatelet therapy, most notably DAPT, which evaluated thionopyridines versus for 12 months versus 30 months, and Pegasus, which evaluated the role of ticagrelor in chronic patients 3 years after myocardial infarction versus monotherapy with aspirin. So it is important that actually all this evidence has been analyzed in these guidelines and has been put into context. So of course there's a lot of information that you will be seeing across this session, and of course you have to go through the document to get that. But I would like to emphasize some of the key concepts that is. So for the long-term duration of dual antiplatelet therapy, the first question is about stent thrombosis prevention, because that was one of the concepts that started initially and still remained, and as the DAPT trial was tested, and you could see that actually longer DAPT duration actually prevents stent thrombosis, but more importantly, actually it prevents also non-stent thrombosis related myocardial infarction, and as you can see, even to a large extent. Please note that the number or the proportion of MIs prevented by stent thrombosis was much lower than prevented by non-stent thrombosis. So it's not only about stent thrombosis, it's not only about treatment of stents, but a treatment of the disease. Is it about different type of stents And this sub-analysis of the DAPT trial shows that actually there was consistency in the different trial of stents, and this sub-analysis of the Pegasus trial with ticagrelor 60 milligrams actually shows that there was no difference between the type of stents, but also there was not even difference between the patients who were treated or were not with prior PCI. So the answer is no. It's not only about preventing stent thrombosis. It's not about the type of stents. It's not even about the strategy that the patients are treated. So that brings us to the key decisions on dual antiplatelet therapy. It's not only stents. So we have to make decisions on our patients with coronary artery disease, with ischemic heart disease, and we need to make a decision on the indications. What is the drug choice? You saw there's several drugs that can be used. Switches, if anything, if they need to be done. Time of initiation, possibility of interruptions, and DAPT duration. So there's a number of clinical decisions that have to be made. And how can we make these decisions? Well, as we have seen from the very brief summary of the evidence, and you will get more details in the later presentations, is that there's a number of clinical items that we need to take into consideration. First one is clinical presentation or indication, whether the patient has a stable coronary artery disease or acute coronary syndrome. Sometimes it's a difference between non-STEMI and STEMI. Treatment modality, whether the patient was treated with PCI, cavitary medical therapy. Devices used, and I mentioned that actually it seems not to be for longer term differences in the devices, but I will show you and you will hear later that there's an exception on that. Of course, the bleeding risk. I mean, most of these trials show that there's an evidence of being a stronger and longer use of dual antiplatelet therapy, but at the price of increasing bleeding risk. So that is something which is very important, and particularly on patients, in patients who are on oral anticoagulation, in which a bleeding risk goes really very high. So it's a very difficult decision how to combine dual antiplatelet therapy with oral anticoagulation. For that, you will see that we have shown and prepared some of these scores that have been developed for the decision maker, some flow charts that you will be hopefully will help you making the decisions. So this is a framework of what we will see in the next presentation. So you will see the different therapies that the patient have been receiving with coronary artery disease, whether the patients were treated with PCI, CABG, or medical treatment alone. Of course, the second thing is whether the patient was stable in the time of indication. It was an acute coronary syndrome. On patients treated with PCI, and here you can see that now drug-eluting stents and bare metal stents are put together in the same line of decision, also drug-coated balloons, which are probably anecdotal, but also you see that the only difference is bioreabsorbable stents, which are in a different decision line. Finally, you will see whether the patient is at high bleeding risk. That's an important question for the decisions. And then you will see in the algorithms in the tables from the time of initiation on DAPT, which may be stent implantation, or the time of initiation in acute coronary syndromes, which may differ, for the different timelines and durations, you will find recommendations, which may be no indications unless there's one other indication, not for the particular case. And of course, the traditional class 1, 2A, 2B, 2, and 3 recommendations that the ESC guidelines use. In the document, you will find instruments like this RIS score for the duration, for deciding longer or shorter duration on DAPT, and you have this table with the precise DAPT and DAPT scoring, which I will not get. It will be commented later on. And you will see also other different instruments such as flowcharts and algorithms. For instance, this one for drug switching in acute care in the acute setting for patients who are treated initially with clopidogrel or ticagrelor and has to be changed. So there will be, let's say, easy to understand ways of something which is difficult really to make in terms of clinical decision making. You will find also some other algorithms of how to stop and retake dual antiplatelet therapy in situations such as bleeding, such as urgent, or such as elective surgery, which will try to help you making these decisions. So as a summary, ladies and gentlemen, the fascinating story of dual antiplatelet therapy has taught us that DAPT is definitely useful for the treatment of stents and prevention of stent thrombosis, but it's much more than that. It's actually an active treatment for patients with acute coronary syndromes and also with a stable chronic coronary artery disease and vascular disease in general. You have seen all the possibilities, all the choices that we can make on using dual antiplatelet therapy. So actually that makes that the different decisions to make, such as the indication, the time of initiation, the choice of the drug, the optimal drug for each setting, each situation, when or how to interrupt these drugs, the duration of dual antiplatelet therapy may be complex and is frequently complex. And for that, several factors should be taken into account, including the clinical setting, the treatment modality, sometimes the devices, and you'll hear more about that, the bleeding risk and concomitant therapies. We really hope that all the work that this task force has done will help you deciding the best treatment for your patients. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Hector, for this overview. I love the central illustration, which shows the tremendous amount of work that has been done within 20 years. And just before that, we took out anticoagulants just before, you know, establishing the benefit of DAPT in stented patients. And then now, 20 years later, my impression is that anticoagulants may be back.
Yeah.
With the COMPASS study. So what is your thoughts about that?
Well, I think it's, again, as I mentioned, this is a really exciting field. We just focus on dual antiplatelet therapy, but it is about antithrombotic therapy. There's no question that the role of thrombosis in acute and chronic setting is very important. I think there's some of the new trials, and some of these trials are talking that we still don't fully understand all the pathophysiology in the different situation, which is the coronary syndromes. We know that it's an acute thrombosis, and we need to be aggressive. We just need to balance the benefit of being very aggressive and the bleeding risk. But now we are learning, and the new trials, the combinations, and for instance, this morning was Compass presented, in which actually the addition of low dose anticoagulation actually can prevent ischemic events. So I think that will add a new, let's say, complexity, item of complexity in the decision maker whether go for prolonged dual antiplatelet therapy or selective low dose anticoagulation. I think that this emphasizes that we still need more research in understanding the pathophysiology, and definitely will have to make us be very careful about the way we make the decisions with the use of dual antiplatelet therapy or in a way of antithrombotic therapy.
Thank you.